victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Death could not keep his prey. Jesus, my Savior, he tore the bars away. Jesus, my Lord, up from the grave he arose with the mighty triumph o'er his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign.
Plan. The heavens and earth were parted with the power of his hands. He used his thoughts and words in his magnificent way and commanded the entire world to exist in 6 consecutive days. On the 7th day, God rested from his handiwork and then from the dust created man to govern all the earth. The Father was pleased with everything and went according to his plan, and then lovingly he created a woman to accompany the man. He named the loved ones Adam and Eve. His plan became fulfilled. They were designed to live forever and were given the gift of free will. But sin tempted his children. They failed to understand that disobedience caused a separation between the Creator of all and man. Satan appeared before them. It seemed that darkness had won. Eternal life for man relied on the Father sending his Son. Then at the appointed time, God knew it must be done. To save us from the gates of hell, he sent the Anointed One. They called him Jesus, the Amen. Sacrificial Lamb, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am.
Amen.
He lived among the people with humility and grace. The purpose of his mission was to save the human race. His time on earth was limited. There was so much to tell. Through miracles and parables, he taught the people well. There were countless unbelievers. God's truth was denied. They accused him and loudly shouted for him to be crucified. They made him trudge to Golgotha. He was tortured, mocked, and scorned. Blood flowed down his beaten face because of a crown of thorns. Nails were pierced through his flesh. There were some who felt such loss. Jesus was left to die upon a wooden cross. The Savior said, "It is finished," and died on that sorrowful day. But death had no sting, for victory was won. He rose and the stone rolled away.
Amen.
He's the Alpha and Omega, the Father, Holy Spirit, and Son. And because of his omnipotence, the three together are one. He'll never leave nor forsake us.
Amen.
And we must understand everything happens because of love. It's the Master's plan.
Thank you.
Though despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary.
Samaria, and then to the utmost parts of the world.
The good news traveled into Europe and Asia and Africa and even into America.
Amen.
And that's where I heard the good news. I was just 8 years old when I heard the good news about Jesus in Vacation Bible School. I'm so thankful for those faithful teachers who were willing to give up a week of their summer to share with me.
Now, it's our responsibility to do the same thing, and so we share the good news with you.
Jesus came to be our Savior.
He willingly gave his life on the cross to pay for our sins.
He conquered death.
And he has provided the way for us to be with him in heaven for all eternity.
That really is great news.
It is news worth sharing.
So don't keep it to yourself.
Pass it on.
Tell it to your family.
Inform your friends at work.
Talk to your neighbors.
Shout it from the mountaintops.
Spread the news throughout the land. Jesus saves.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Something marvelous, amazing, yet it's true. they were playing that song, my heart fills with delight in knowing that I can come to that garden of prayer, that I can meet with you anytime, anywhere, day or night, that you're always there, you're always listening. You never say no. Father, Lord, we're just delighted that you're alive. We serve a risen Savior. He's alive within us, his believers. Father, Lord, as we celebrate this day of resurrection, as we look into the Word of God, I pray for leadership and guidance and unction of Holy Spirit. Lord, would you help me to say those things that are necessary, nothing more, nothing less? And would the spoken word this morning go out and touch hearts? May the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, the church of the redeemed, be encouraged this morning, lifted up. May those who are walking afar off from you this morning, they may be your children, but they're not rejoicing as they should. They're not living as they should. May the word of God touch and convict and wrench that heart, that they find a place of repentance and an altar. And then, Father, if there's any that's lost today, our heart breaks for them. Father, I pray, Lord, that Holy Spirit conviction would be real in their hearts today. They could not walk out of this church without coming to know you as their Savior and their Lord. Take this service today, the singing that's already lifted our hearts to the portals of heaven. We're rejoicing in it. And the word of God is now to be spoken. And use it for your glory in Christ's name. Amen. Book of Luke, chapter 23, verse 26. And as they led him away, Christ, they laid hold on one Simon, a Cyrenian, coming out of the country, and on him they laid the cross that he might bear it after Jesus. And there followed him a great company of people, of women, also bewailed and lamented him. But Jesus, turning and said unto them, Daughters of Jerusalem, weep not for me, but weep for yourself and your children. For behold, the days are coming, in which they shall say, Blessed are they that are barren, and the womb that never bare, and for the paps that never gave suck. Then shall they begin to say to the mountains, Fall on us, and to the hills, cover us. For if they do these things in a green tree, what shall be done in the dry? I'll read the next couple of verses in a moment, but the thought just crossed my mind. Here our Savior is being led to his death. After being beaten and bruised with a cat of nine tails, beard plucked off of his face, hit with fists, spat upon, crowned with thorns, carrying his cross, he had such great compassion in his heart that he turned and looked at those following him that were crying and weeping and mourning. And he says, Don't weep for me, weep for yourself. Don't mourn for me, mourn for yourself. Because I am going to do this for you. Look with me in verse 32. And there were also two others, malefactors, led with him to be put to death. And when they were come to the place, which is called Calvary, there they crucified him, and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Let's read that verse again, if you will. And when they were come to the place, which is called Calvary, there they crucified him, and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. The Bible is full of several days which mentions the days of Christ or the life of Christ. Multitudes of times throughout the Bible you find different things about what he done on a particular day or the significance of his day, and etc. But here's just a few. The Bible talks about the day of his birth, the day of his death, the day of his resurrection. It talks about the day of his ascension into heaven to be at the Father's right hand where he is today. But praise the Lord, it doesn't stop there. He also talks about the day of his returning. It talks about the day of his wedding himself to the bride. There's other days. Days such as the day of judgment, the judgment seat of Christ. The day of the great white throne judgment in which he rules and reigns. But today I want to look at two of these days, only two. I want to look today at the day of his crucifixion or his death, and then the day of his glorious resurrection. So follow me, if you would, in the Word of God. First, we find the day of his horrible, vicious, mean, cruel, painful death. And when they came to the place, which is called Calvary, there they crucified him. I want us to look within this verse at one phrase, one four-letter, four-word phrase. There they crucified him. What a statement. You know, it's probably the greatest statement of all times. It has great significance. There they crucified him. The first word of this phrase is there. The first word of this text, there, may be looked upon as furnishing us the first account of the indictment against man. It also supplies us or gives us a location of the most horrible death of all times. The most horrible death of all times. We'll touch on that just in a little bit. There they crucified him. The location. The place. Up until the day of Christ's death, the place was called Golgotha. Mark, Matthew, John, all three records the name of that hill, which is about a half a mile outside of Jerusalem, as a place called Golgotha. Let me read these three verses for you. Matthew says in 27:33, and when we came to the place which to the place called Golgotha, is to say the place of a skull. Mark records it in 15:22 when he says, and they bring him unto the place called Golgotha, which is being interpreted the place of the skull. And John also records it, and he was bearing his cross in verse 17 of chapter 19, and went forth into the place called the place of the skull, which is being interpreted, or which being called in Hebrew, Golgotha. These three apostles, these three writers, seem to place the emphasis upon the common name of the hill outside of Jerusalem, which is related to the punishment of criminals, place of the skull, the place of crucifixion. They give it to us in the past tense, or the sense of being, it's a place that's always been called this. It's a place that is called this on this day that Christ was dying. Place of the skull. The significance of this place is that it was the place where the most common criminals, the meanest of the mean, the most wicked of the wicked, the vilest of the vile, the murderers, the sorcerers, the adulterers, the fornicators, the thieves, whoever, the wicked, was led out to die a lingering death. For it was on this place called Golgotha that the Romans had instituted the most vilest. If you remember last week, we talked about the death and how horrifying it was. It was a place called the skull. Now, there were some features of this hill that resembled that of a human skull. It had some caves in it that signifies the eyes and the nose and the mouth and the ears. And inside these holes in this mountain lived wild dogs, vicious. One writer said probably dogs that had rabies and all sorts of diseases. Why were they living there? I'll tell you in a minute. On the top of this hill, there were a few trees scattered there, and there was huge nests in those trees of vultures and buzzards. So it looked like a skull. It had the features of a skull. But not only did it stop there, it was littered with skulls, skeletons that had been picked clean with the vultures and the buzzards. There laid skeletons of people whose bodies were not claimed. You see, no one wanted to claim the body of a criminal. Nobody wanted to claim a family member who was a murderer, a rapist. Nobody wanted that body to take it and bury it. So it hung on the cross until the person died, and then they took it off and they just slung it down the hillside for the body to decay in the sun of that day. Then out from in the crevices and the caves and the holes in this place called the skull would venture out these dogs that were foaming at the mouth, and they were fighting each other and biting each other just so they could pick the bones, the flesh of these criminals that had died. Horrible scene. Place of the skull. Place of judgment. Place, probably the most horrifying place I've ever read about. And there, up that hillside, walked my Lord, carrying his cross. There he laid down on that cross, voluntarily stretched out his hands, voluntarily allowed them to nail him to the cross, and they picked it up and with a great thug and they placed it into the ground. But I saw something that I'd never seen before. I've preached many messages from this text. I've preached many messages on crucifixion on Calvary. But I saw something that Luke gave us that I'd never seen before. I want you to look at the text. And it says in that verse, Luke records the place which is called Calvary. The place which is called Calvary. The place where Christ died for the sins of all mankind. The sinless one is sacrificed for the sinner. The guiltless, sinless, perfect Son of God died on the cross for the sins of all mankind. And it is thus recorded for the first time and the only time in the Word of God, the place which is called Calvary. Calvary. You see, Matthew, Mark, and John called it as a place which was called Calvary, or a place called Calvary. But now that my Savior has died on the cross, now that he has sacrificed himself in his blood for the remission of sins, now that he has given himself in death that we might enjoy his life and life abundantly and life eternally, Luke changes, or God instructs Luke to change the name from Golgotha to Calvary. You see, Golgotha was a place of human judgment, but it became God's final offering, altar, and his final sacrifice for the forgiveness of sins of all mankind. May I say to you this morning, there would never have been a Calvary if Christ had not died there. It would still be in Golgotha. It would still be in a place of human judgment. But thanks be unto God, and thanks be unto our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who willingly, in obedience to his Father's desire, died on that mountainside, on that hillside. There he gave himself willingly for our sins. There he was the sacrificial lamb dying once and for all of mankind. There would be no more need for Golgotha for those who accepted Calvary. Amen? Think about that. There would be no more need for Golgotha, a place of human judgment and misery, for those who accepted Calvary as Christ had died for our sins. So thank God for Calvary. Aren't you glad that you don't have to go to a Golgotha? But because he died, you can go to Calvary and kneel at the foot of the cross and say, Lord, I should have been crucified at Calvary, but you at Golgotha, but you was crucified at Calvary. So therefore, the punishment that I deserved, you took. Thank God for Calvary. The second word in that phrase, they crucified him. They crucified him. Gives us a further point of indictment. That all men must die for their sins. But it also gives us an idea of who was responsible for his death. They crucified him. His murderers or his executioners in this horrible death were men among whom Christ had wrought his miracles and exercised his pure and helpful ministry. Think about who was crucifying Christ. First of all, it was those Jews that refused to accept him as Lord, as King. You see, the Jews of that day wasn't looking for a redeemer. They were looking for a political leader. It's time that we in the United States of America quit looking for a political leader and start looking for a redeemer, by the way. But they, amongst whom he had healed people, he had caused blind eyes to open and deaf ears to hear. He had caused the lame to walk and the withered hands to reach out. He had cleansed the sin of leprosy and gave new flesh to those leopards. It was those that he walked with for 3.5 years. Those who administered in their cities, in their towns, in their byways, in the highways. It was those people whom he had seen him do all that only God could do. Only God could do those things. As Nicodemus says, that we know you come from God because only God could do these things. But these were people of envy, hatred, indifference, that nailed Christ to the cross. That nailed him to the cross. Surely, we need to realize and recognize that my sin was responsible. Your sin was responsible. God placed on the shoulders of his Son at Calvary the sin of all mankind. But these mean, cruel, vile, indifferent, hateful murderers, executioners, those that cried from the depths of their heart and the depths of their voice, crucify him, away with him, we will not have him to be our king. They were only players in God's divine plan. They were only fulfilling the prophecy of Christ that he gave. Yes, these players in God's divine plan were those, even those that nailed him to the cross, he was willing to redeem. We find recorded in Revelation chapter 13 and verse 8 that his death wasn't accidental. His death wasn't just something that happened. It wasn't a rage of the moment. It wasn't the actions of people who just didn't like him. But it was a deliberate divine plan that God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit devised that man might live with them forever. For we find in Revelation 3:8, and all them that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names, listen, and all they that dwell on the earth shall worship him, whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, slain from the foundation of the world. May I tell you this morning that whether you want to realize it or not, you're a sinner. I'm a sinner. The Word of God says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's none that's righteous, no, not one, for all are sinners. But somewhere back in the eons of time, now I don't understand this, I'm just going to give it to you because the Word of God says it. Somewhere beyond, before creation, before Christ, the Creator, stepped out on nothing and spoke by the power of His Word everything to existence that we know. God loved me. And God loved you. Knowing that His creation, His special beings that He created would sin, would fall, would turn their back on Him, would deny Him. Yet before the foundation of the world, He planned our redemption. He planned Calvary. And even as Christ said from the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Look at the third word of that phrase. Crucified him. Crucified him. The act of enforcing the punishment for a crime. The definite, deliberate act of enforcing punishment for a crime. But wait a minute. He wasn't a criminal. He never done anything wrong. There was no guile found in his mouth. But they deliberately took my Savior and crucified him. What hardness, what callousness of heart was exhibited that day. I want you to let this sink in. Please let this sink into your heart. To your mind. That sin should show or display such exceedingly sinfulness once and for all. You see, on that cross crucified Christ was bearing the sin of all the world, of all mankind. Can you imagine? Oh my, it was enough that he took my sin. How horrible a burden that was. But he took yours and yours and yours and yours and yours and yours and the sin of all mankind upon his shoulders that day. Sin become exceedingly sinful. Truly detestable that it might be detested. Hideous as black as the perdition of hell itself. So horrible was the display of crucifixion that our sinful spirits might even sink back into awe and trembling. That he done it for me? Yes, for in all of this, with all that what sin is, with all of its contempt and its callousness and its sight of suffering, the scorn of the innocent, the hatred of purity, the condemning of darker deeds, the rejection of God himself, if his plan interferes with ours and our selfish schemes. Yet Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. Romans chapter 5 and verse 8 says, but God commended his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I'm so glad I serve a God who loved me so much that he died for me. You see, that's the only God that there is, by the way. But the world is full of people who serve gods that says, you must do this, and you must do that. You must correct yourself. You must straighten up your life. You must work. You must do this. You must turn over a new leaf. You must come unto me. No, Christ came unto us while we were yet sinners, went to the cross of Calvary, and died for us. Christ done it all. God the Father, God the Son, and God Holy Spirit loved us while we were yet sinners. Thank God for his crucifixion. And then they crucified him with a capital H. The final and hopeful word of this phrase is him. For it sheds a light upon us that we see the divine Redeemer working in the midst of death. The one who gives eternal life in the midst of eternal death. The one who brings the light, the glorious light of the gospel of Christ. Eternal light in the midst of eternal darkness. The one who said, the thief cometh but to steal and kill and destroy. But I am come that they might have life and they might have it more abundantly. Dying on the cross. Think about this. He didn't have to. He didn't have to. But he wanted to. He didn't have to, but he wanted us. He didn't have to love us, but he chose to love us. I thought about this. Investment. Investment in souls. Now this church, main purpose, main focus is to invest in souls. Amen? Invest in souls of others. But think about this. When Christ came, he invested all of himself. He invested all of heaven. He invested all of the Godhead. On the cross of Calvary, he invested all of his worth, all of his being, all that he was. That makes, even in a contemptible death, a horrible death, he invested it all that it might be profitable for us. You see, for the word of God says, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. It says that you and I were not redeemed by corruptible things and things of this world, but by the precious blood of the Lamb of God without blemish and without spot. He invested all of heaven. May I say, he invested all of heaven's best for earth's worst, you and I. It was on the cross of Calvary that he took his robe of righteousness, and all that will bow at his feet, he took off his robe of righteousness, invested it in us, and gave us his righteousness. On the hillside that day at Calvary was three crosses, two representing Golgotha, where sinful men were dying and paying the wages of their sins. Because the word of God is still true, the wages of sin is death. But our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, was not hanging on the center cross by chance. But by divine appointment, he was on the center cross. Think about this. For he was dying on Calvary. The final sacrifice for man's sin. He was dying for the man on his right and the man on his left, signifying that he was dying for all of mankind throughout the entire universe of his creation, for everybody that had ever been born on the top side of the earth, from the first Adam to the last. He was dying for all of mankind on that center cross, that we as that center on his right might believe and enjoy paradise with him. Or as the one on his left, reject him and end up in hell forever. You see, he was dying for the whosoever's. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, that all the world through him might be saved. What a great Redeemer. What a great Savior who died on the cross of Calvary. If he's your Redeemer and your Lord, give him praise in God's house today. What a horrible day of his death. But now let's look at the day of his glorious resurrection. You see, after the death of Christ, those who loved him came and begged for his body, took it down off the cross, and instead of it being thrown out on the hillside to be consumed with the fowls of the air and the dogs of the day, they placed it in a tomb. And then the Jewish leaders went to Pilate and said, you must seal that tomb. You must put a stone in. You must seal that tomb because somebody might come and steal his body to fool us that he's alive. And they even placed guards there. Luke records it in Luke 24. Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came into the sepulcher, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher. Hallelujah. And they entered in, and they found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, as they were much troubled thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments, two angelic messengers. And as they were afraid, they bowed their faces to the earth. And they said unto them, why seek ye the living among the dead? What a question. Angels looked at them and says, why are you here in the garden of graves? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he spoke unto you the words when he was yet in Galilee, saying, Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day raise again. And they remembered his words. You see, on that first Easter morning, the rim of nature became symbolic of the rim of grace. On that first Easter morning, the sun, the S-U-N, began to rise over the hill called Calvary now, dispelling the fear of death, dispelling the judgment of death. And the sun's rays began to destroy the shadow of an empty cross. But at the same time that the S-U-N was rising over the hill called Calvary, in the garden of the graves, the S-O-N, the Son of God, the Savior who sacrificed himself, arose from the dead, leaving an empty tomb, just as he promised he would do. Hallelujah! Praise the Lord. So on that first Easter that had begun with a gloomy night, at the breaking of day became the bright and promising dawn. That first Easter day, that first Easter morning, was brighter than all the mornings that those people had ever had in their life. It was more gracious. It was more revealing than anything in their life had ever been. Why? Because of the words of the angels. Listen at this. Why seek you a living among the dead? Why did you come here looking for Christ? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was first yet in Galilee, saying the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men to be crucified, and on the third day he arose. and what words they were from the messengers of heaven. They were words given to the followers of Christ, his own words, to create in them, in their minds, in their hearts, a time of joy, the ultimate time of joy. They had never known joy like they know now. Their Savior that had died at Calvary was no longer dead, but he arose from the dead. Amen. And the messengers was giving them that great news. You see, that's exactly what Christ's true messengers or preachers today need to be doing for the believers of Christ. They need to give forth the words of Christ to his followers. He is alive. He is risen. But then there's something better than that. You say, what's better than preaching the Word of God? John records it in John chapter 20. And seeth the two angels in white sitting, and one on the at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus was lain. And they said unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? And she said unto them, Because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they laid him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself around or back, and saw Jesus standing, and knew not it was Jesus. But listen to this. If this don't get you fired up your woods with, if this don't get your heart pumping, you just might be dead. Jesus looked at her and said, Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, said unto him, Sir, if thou have borne him thence, please tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him. And Jesus said unto her, Mary. I'm about to have myself a spell. Jesus said unto her, Mary. She turned herself and said unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. Jesus said unto her, Touch me not, for I have not yet ascended to my Father, and I go to my brethren. And go to my brethren and say unto them, I will ascend unto my Father and your Father and to my God and my God. But listen to this. This thrills my heart. This is exciting. The personal words of Jesus to his followers. Woman. Mary. Woman in the sense of many. Mary in the sense of personally. You see, there are times in the lives of believers when, just as Mary heard Christ speak, that through the Holy Spirit that lives and dwells within us, Christ personally speaks his words to us. For Christ surely knows the names of all the believers personally. Surely he does. For look at what John said. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Here we find the word whosoever is the name for all of mankind. For all of mankind. But be sure that those who come to Christ in salvation is known of Christ personally, by name. You say, really? Christ knows me by name? Yes. And he talks to you personally. You say, how does Christ talk to me? If you've ever opened your Bible and read the Word of God, it's Christ talking to you personally. You don't have to wait till this preacher preaches from the Word to hear the words of the message. No, Christ will open it to your heart, to your mind, to your understanding personally. But you say, preacher, he knows me personally. Listen to Revelation 21:27. And there shall in no wise enter into anything that defileth into heaven, neither whosoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. Your name is written down in glory. Amen? That ought to make any of us Baptists shout. That ought to make us have a Pentecostal experience of the Holy Spirit moving within our heart, that we could say, glory, hallelujah, God knows my name. How happy could we be? How much rejoicing should we have to know that my name is written in glory? And my indebtedness there is written, paid in full by the blood of the Lamb. My sins are gone. Hallelujah. What a day of resurrection. Day was brighter because Christ's resurrection from the dead, death and grave has been conquered by his resurrection. Death and grave has been conquered. Listen as Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall it be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. It simply says this, because of Calvary, because of his resurrection, when it comes my time to die, I can look death in the face and I can say, I don't fear you, death. I don't fear you, grave. I have conquered you. You are nothing to me. You hold no power against me because Jesus Christ died, rose again, and is alive today. Death holds no fear. We are more than conquerors through him that loved us and gave himself for us. So when it comes our time to die, don't cry yourself to death. Shout yourself to death. And by the way, when I die and they roll my body in front of this church, I want you to rejoice. Why? Because of the brightness of the fact that Christ lives, all Christians will live forever. John says in chapter 11, 25 through 26, Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though he were dead in trespasses and sin, yet shall he live. Isn't that wonderful? But let's read the next little phrase. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Hallelujah. I'll never die. I'll live forever in the presence of the one who loved me and gave himself for me. And it was a brighter day on that first Easter as it is today because Christ has a resurrected body. And all believers will have a body just like his. Amen. Listen to this. For our conversation in Philippians chapter 3, for our conversation is in heaven, from whence we also look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change this vile body, that it might be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able to subdue all things unto himself. Are you hurting this morning? Do you have cancer? Do you have arthritis? Do you have Parkinson's? Do you have a headache? Is your big toe or your little toe hurting this morning? Do you have a skin problem? Do you need glasses? Do you need hearing aids? Do you have some artificial teeth in your mouth? Do you ever get a toothache? Rejoice with me. Amen. Because there's coming a day, on that day of final resurrection, on the day that the church is lifted out of here, that somewhere between here and heaven, we're going to shed this old body that hurts and aches, that gives us troubles and problems, and we just can't stand it anymore. And we are aching and we're hurting. Somewhere between heaven and here in heaven, we're going to change.